What's up, everybody? Welcome to another edition of the Trophy Talk Podcast. It's episode number 43. I'm Brandon, and today I am joined by Prince.
Hey there.
And Ace.
Hiya.
We have a magical, wonderful, amazing, probably pretty short episode to do for you today. We're going to go over fun news stuff. We're going to discuss what our personal goals are for the rest of the year for video games. You're not going to hear about our cheesy life stories or anything like that. And if we have time, maybe we'll get around to some trivia. maybe. We'll see. So, starting off the news, it turns out that the Uncharted series may not be done yet.
Surprise.
Yeah, if you're surprised by that, I've got a bridge to sell you.
Yeah. It will never be done, isn't it?
No, I mean, they've really kind of hit big on Uncharted, and it'd be silly for them to stop making them.
Yeah, but you know that the Halo series was done after Halo 3, right? There aren't any more.
Wow.
Sorry to tell you, Prince, there are a few more after that.
No, but Master Chief's whole arc was done, so they didn't need to introduce a new protagonist or anything like that, right?
No, they didn't. There's a robot in one of the games, and he's kind of lame. Yeah. Anyways.
So I bet the Uncharted series would do really well if you take all the three best characters, sideline them, and then take the characters that basically get no screen time and make them the main characters. That's a winning formula.
That's legacy, isn't it?
Oh, they beat me to it.
Yeah. So maybe that just means that there's plenty more stories to tell if you do that.
I mean, actually, genuinely, I quite liked the Cutter character. Maybe we're biased because he was very British. The fact that there are a few side characters that are moderately interesting doesn't really mean that they're replacements for the main characters that pin the whole series together.
Certainly not. I mean, we'll find out what the next game is looking like. I mean, that's coming out August 22nd, I think, so it's not too far away.
Don't get me wrong, I think Lost Legacy will be good because the team that makes it is very good, the writing is good, and the gameplay is good, but, you know, you might lose the charm.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not going to say I'm particularly interested in Chloe or Nadine, really.
Oh, you say that now, but I mean, you know, who was that interested in Lara Croft? And now, you know, what's the name of that one on the robotic dinosaurs game?
Horizon,
yeah.
Those characters were never second fiddle to anyone. Well, not even second fiddle. Like, Sully could be a main character. These are all, like, third, fourth, like, seat.
Each person is a hero in their own video game. don't need to put them down.
I mean,
that sounds something like Aquaman had a game, he would be saying that.
Yeah. I mean, that's the thing, isn't it? Yeah, marketing's not going to turn around and go, yeah, oh, this is the last one, we're done. You know, of course, they're never going to give that answer, are they? They said, no, there's more life in it. It's either going to be a sequel to Lost Legacy, or they may go back to Drake, or they may do someone else, or
I think Drake might join one.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, being realistic, they could
Strange
make
things have happened.
three terrible games, and they could all flop and crash and burn, and then that fourth game afterwards, they'd say, "Oh, it's young Nathan Drake," and sell like crazy. So
there you go. Yeah, pretty cool, young Nathan Drake.
Yeah. Modern Warfare Remaster, huh?
Or alternative universes, you can get all crazy, can't they?
Well, yeah, they'll get into the mystical stuff. Speaking of alternative universes, Modern Warfare Remaster should be now available on the PSN. PlayStation's getting it as a standalone title first, and then I guess it's going to Xbox and whatnot. But it should be available now for $40, containing the full campaign and the 16 base multiplayer maps. So not all the maps.
What a terrible caveat.
I know. So if you now buy the standalone version of this 10-year-old game, you now have the option to go and buy even more stuff from Activision.
Strictly for Activision fans, maybe, then.
So we knew this would happen. We didn't know when it would happen because, I mean, they denied it, but it was obvious. And here it is.
If you buy this,
where's Dave?
You're
not are we locked
into their game, but you're also endorsing them.
Yes.
Have we locked Dave away because he would be screaming at the podcast about now?
Yeah, probably.
In my mind, there's an impression of Dave playing, but I'm not going to say out loud.
Yeah, no, I don't want to get, you know, taken off the air or anything. So,
plus, my accent would be terrible.
Oh, yeah, yeah. So, a different shooter game, PlayerUnknown Battlegrounds, may one day come to PS4. Maybe, sort of. When asked point blank about this, the lead developer was kind of cagey and was like, oh, we're always looking for perspective, yada, yada. So they didn't say no. That means that at some point it may come. But then again, they also were kind of cagey about No Man's Sky, and, you know, that still hasn't happened. So who knows what'll actually happen?
So this was them refuting a claim that a newspaper posted that it was an Xbox exclusive, wasn't it? And they said, well, actually, no, yeah, it's not exclusive. We could do anything, you know.
Yep. I mean, it's not like huge news, except that the game is growing at a ridiculous rate and people are really into it. So that'd be really cool if that were the case. Mm. I will probably play it when it comes to Xbox because I'm interested to see what the hullabaloo is all about.
Yeah, that should be a quick port, isn't it? Obviously PC to Xbox, but I suppose there's probably a bit more involved to a PlayStation 4 port.
No, they're still all work on the same core.
Not as bad as PS3 was, but yeah.
Well, I mean, it's all PC architecture, so I mean, it's just a matter of, it's probably, I can't imagine that it's too difficult comparatively. But Skull and Bones will have story campaign. Woo!
So remind us what Skull and Bones is.
So Skull and Bones is Assassin's Creed Black Flag, but minus the assassinating. Yeah, that.
Assassinating?
I'm talking about the goings-on of the assassin, not necessarily the killing.
I'd caveat that with maybe the covert silent assassin killing, because you do hop onto other ships and can run people through with his sword, so you could say that's an assassination of a type.
I mean, I don't know how much on foot stuff there will actually be, but regardless, so they showed a bunch of, they showed like PvP stuff, like a 5-on-5 where you're sailing the boats and shooting at people and whatever else. And so it is nice to know that they will actually have a story campaign. They have not really elaborated on what that will be, but if you want to play the game by yourself, it seems like you should be able to. So
it could be, it could end up being a sort of Call of Duty situation where it's designed to have a few hours of story and then a lot of multiplayer, in contrast to the normal Assassin's Creed games, which are many, many hours of story and a few hours of multiplayer.
Yeah, I would imagine that it's much more like that, especially I think it's probably important for this game to have that, because you may not necessarily be getting Assassin's Creed fans, and even if you did, it only showed up in a couple of games. It's like, I think you really need to provide a place for people to get used to what the game is and how it controls. So, I mean, I think like a shooter, this is going to be probably a traditional story campaign where you go through the motions. There's a story to string you along, but really it's there so that you can learn the mechanics so that you're prepared to play against people.
Well, if it's at the core competitive multiplayer game, it reminds me of some of those old MMORPGs, which I'm not quite sure if they're still going. Yeah, I don't know if they're still going or not, but they were sort of very territory based, weren't they? And they kind of had big events or something that they kind of mentioned, and it was kind of explained as a campaign with story bits, but really it was just like a continuous online world, really, wasn't it? It's not what you'd really call as like a single player story bit.
So I
suspect it's probably going to lean more towards that than your traditional single player campaign, but I hope to be proved wrong. We'll see.
Yeah, I mean, Ubisoft does thankfully do a wide variety of games in that regard. You've got your Far Cry's, which are pretty strictly single player with the occasional co-op thing. But and then you've got your purely online games like Rainbow Six and what have you. Sorry, Siege, to be clear. So it could go either way. You might be right, but it does say that you'll have a story campaign, so I imagine that it'll be a little bit more lax. Final Fantasy XIV was hit by a DDOS attack, or a DDoS attack. Apparently, when they launched their Stormblood expansion to the game, they started getting hit by a DDoS attack, and then for a little while, nobody noticed because they were like, oh, we've got a bunch of new players playing. But it turns out, yeah, they took the servers down for maintenance and realized that they were getting a huge amount of activity for a game that should be seeing pretty much no activity. And they realized that they were under attack. So if you couldn't access the content that you were trying to get to, that may be a good portion of why that happened.
I don't know what's more ridiculous, the fact that they didn't notice that, or the fact that it was right after they released an expansion called Stormblood.
Yeah.
Oh dear. Yeah. I mean, that's not good, really, not to kind of figure it out until long after they took them down and thought, still quite busy. How many people do they think came back to it that would equate to a DDoS attack? I mean, that's kind of thinking, wow, people really had to jump back at this. It's the most popular thing since sliced bread to think.
Depends on the size of the attack.
Yeah.
No, that's true.
Yeah,
it could have been a minor DDoS, I suppose.
Yeah, and that's probably what it was. It was not a huge DDoS attack, and so Stormblood is supposed to be, I think, so far the biggest expansion that they've done. So it wouldn't surprise me if they were expecting significantly more players than their previous expansions. But who knows? Yeah, I kind of agree. Somebody at Square Enix must have been sitting there scratching their head and went, maybe something else is up here. Maybe there's something else going on. And then it was like, everybody else seems to be doing fine.
Yeah, I mean, it might return people who played before, but it's not exactly going to draw in new people, is it? I mean, how good of expansion is it?
Could be magical. I don't know. I don't know.
I think the game servers...
I might be mistaken. I think they may have done a free period just before the release of the expansion or something. So I don't know if maybe that played into it too. I might be misremembering that. I'm not 100% sure.
Okay.
Yeah, it is suspicious.
Yeah.
You know what? You know what is? I don't know if it's suspicious, but maybe it is. Titanfall 2, is the next free DLC is coming. It's coming today, and it is adding a third weapon slot. So there's that. So basically, the third slot will be reserved for your Titan, anti-Titan weapon. So that way, you can carry a primary weapon, a secondary weapon, and your anti-Titan weapon. Whereas before, it was just a primary weapon, and then you had to choose between carrying a secondary or an anti-Titan weapon. I might be mistaken, but I think that's kind of how the first one worked. So this is not entirely breaking the mold, I guess.
But it is fixing the mold.
Yeah, that's kind of what I was thinking. I was kind of thinking that I can't imagine that this was too hard for them to implement, even if, you know, it wasn't. Like, I feel like this was probably in the code somewhere, or like they had this option and they're flicking a switch. You know, I don't feel like this is going to be like a big deal. It's in there somewhere, I'm sure.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Speaking of persistent online games, for Destiny, the Iron Banner and the Trials of Osiris will be ending. Their last events will be August 1st for Iron Banner and August 11th for the Trials of Osiris, because they are taking that stuff down so that they can revamp it for Destiny 2. I'm not entirely sure why you have to take stuff offline for Destiny 1 for them to work on Destiny 2 stuff.
Obviously, it's just because they want the people who would continue to play this, the diehard fans, to go and buy the new game instead of continuing to play.
Well, yeah, I meant, you know, because so they're taking it down you know, what, a month and a half or something before the next game. So maybe they'll be jonesing and they'll be like, oh man, I need to get back in. But even then, I'm not entirely sure. Like, Iron Banner didn't show up for, I think, a couple of months after the game went live. I mean, I might be crazy, but Trials of Osiris did exist for a while. So I don't know if there was even going to be back online immediately in Destiny 2. But for those of you that want to get your last bits of gear or honors or emblems, what for? Or whatever,
you can't use them in the new game anyway.
Well, I know, but people want to. It's a thing, isn't it? Like when you play a persistent, It's a persistent world thing where, like, people will, you know, play a game and when they log off for the last time, they make sure their character's decked out and looks awesome, and then they log off. So. Weird. And some stuff will, like the emblems, will carry over, or at least some emblems, but I'm not entirely sure how that works. So I don't know if some of this plays into that system or whatever. But if you need stuff out of those, then you've got your time now. You know when you need to do it.
Mm. It's good. It's better to have advance notice than to just say end.
Yeah, yeah, absolutely. And then finally, Remake 2, the Resident Evil 2 remake, is going to be ditching the original voice cast, which is, I don't know if that's unfortunate. I felt compelled to say that it was unfortunate, but I don't know that that's really a problem.
You almost a Jill sandwich.
Well, no, which, no, Resident Evil 2, which actually, that's even worse because I can't come up with a line like that. Yeah, I really got nothing.
You gotta have that old school voice. No, I mean, the big thing here is that Capcom wanted to go with, well, it seems that Capcom wanted to go with non-union voice actors instead of the original cast, which are all union, as far as I know, which is definitely a conscious decision. And they say that it's not related to the voice actors strike, which is obviously a union problem. But it's definitely considerate of that strike or possibility of a strike. Alternatively, so just cost.
The interesting thing is that it seems like it's possible that this information, like, is sort of old news, but just never came out, because these talks may have happened before the strike.
Yeah, that's so, what they're saying.
Yeah, so I mean, it is actually possible that it is unrelated to that. But I don't know where this non-union thing is coming from, because it seems like, so the voice actors are the ones saying that Capcom is going non-union. I mean, I don't know. We don't even know who the new voice cast is. So we really have very little information.
Seemingly that is
so far. Yeah.
Direction.
Yep. But I can't really say that it's too big of a concern. Some people were really up in arms. Apparently there was like a petition about it and whatever.
You'd like a bit of consistency, wouldn't you? And you feel for these voice actors, that is their job. And
oh, certainly. You
know, but how hard would it be for Capcom to stick with them? You know, it does seem like someone thought on paper, we can save a bit of money here and do that, you know.
I mean, I think it's a bigger deal for the person who played Claire, because she, I think, reprised the role at least once with Code Veronica. But the guy who played Leon in Resident Evil 2, I don't think is the same person that played it in Resident Evil 4. So you've actually already got a different voice actor for that. And, you know,
oh, that's true.
And I presume the guy from Resident Evil 4 was the same in Resident Evil 6, or I have no idea. But, I mean, I don't think that's been the same person for quite some time. So it's even like, I don't know that I would want that person back. I probably would want the Resident Evil 4 guy back, you know?
Yeah, I guess it depends on it. You need to have a casting call and kind of get it. I mean, at the end of that, as long as it's, you want it to sound like the character, and like you say, over time, the original voice actor may no longer sound like the character, so you need something that is kind of a bit more in fitting with it, because that's what people are used to. Because especially with games where once you've got the game, it doesn't change, but you play that game a lot, and you can come back to that game years later, and yet it's the same exact voice, but obviously over time, the person's voice will change, and then you hear them in a sequel, and it's like, that doesn't sound the same. Well, it's the same voice actor, but it's obviously changed.
Yeah, I mean, Resi 2 came out in what, like,
20 years ago.
Yeah, 98. So, yeah, it's 20 years ago. The person who played Claire doesn't sound like she's 20, I'd imagine, you know? Yeah. Not to say that she couldn't be. She is a voice actor, so who knows? Yeah,
that's true. But,
that's someone never asked a lady her age.
No.
Yeah, is this, I know, right?
Yeah, is this just for the US region or locality? Or?
Well, I mean, I would imagine that it's at least English-speaking. I know
the
that
English
they
voice from... acting will be for all English.
Right. Yeah, sorry, yeah. English.
They did not mention any Japanese voice actors. They only mentioned the English voice actors, so I'm assuming that right now that only applies to the English voice actors. I don't know how union stuff works in Japan, so...
Yeah. Oh, I wonder if they'd be more upset if they change names over there, or if it's more of us English lot that get a bit more upset about changes.
Yeah, who knows? Especially with all those movies, which... are a decidedly terrible American thing. So,
yeah. I mean, it's unfortunate, and like you say, there'll be petitions and fans upset, but as long as they don't cast someone that's just completely wrong or does a horrible voice not in fitting with the character, then they shouldn't really ruin it.
Yeah, well, I mean, like Prince was saying, Jill Sandwich and all that, I think that odds are that it's going to be better no matter what. Even if they got the original voice cast back, just the amount of care that they would have put into it would have still been much more than it was originally. So,
job description, master of unlocking.
Yes. All right, so that's it for news this week. We're going to move on to the topic of the week. As hinted last week, we are going to discuss what our goals are for the remainder of the year. And I was thinking that this seemed like a particularly appropriate thing to do, maybe like at the beginning of a year. You know, we're coming up on the mid-year point anyway, so we're going to discuss what we're doing for the rest of 2017, but maybe we should revisit this in January or what have you, and set goals for 2018 as well. But so to start off, why don't you start off, Prince? I've been talking quite a bit.
Me?
Yes. Yeah.
Hello, me.
Yeah, you've been a little bit quiet today, so you get to go first.
My goals are the least modest goals.
Nothing wrong with that.
So my sort of PlayStation... Oh, I have to try and... This boring enough as it is when I'm not... And then when I'm not passionate about it, then it makes it worse. But my PlayStation story has been sort of... I got a PS3, what, 8 years ago? And then I sort of played it just casually. And then I think after I sort of started to get off the Xbox side of things, I started to try and improve my completion percentage on the PlayStation side. I was going from, I don't know, about... probably about 60% back then, and I think it was the start of last year probably that I got into the 90s, 90%. And then I hit 98% earlier this year, I think it was. So one of my goals for this year has been 99%, with the true trophies metric of own DLC, which means the DLC is that you've earned a trophy in and you've technically started, so it doesn't include the ones that I haven't bought or haven't started. So 99% would be a nice target. I'm sort of far away from it because I started a few new things, and the other one being 96%, which is all DLC. So that's there to sort of moderate me from skipping DLCs and just trying to get platinums all the time, because I want to actually fully finish a game. When you've got a game that has a lot of DLC, either to expand the story or just to expand the whole experience, then if you want the full experience, you kind of have to play it all, which it sucks from a money side of things. But in terms of being content that you've finished with a game, in terms of like knowing everything there is to know about that game, I think that's the only way to do it.
Mm-hmm. Sounds good. How are your prospects looking?
This month I've been focusing on Sunset Overdrive for the TA playlist, as I mentioned. Yes. But once I go back to it, I'm getting this close to the last few trophies, it becomes you get stuck on more old ones that you started a decade ago, like Streets of Rage 2, which is rage inducing, no question. And The Simpsons Arcade, which is definitely a bad game. But you know, you go back to it after like a year each time, and you get a little bit more, you get better at it, and you get closer to finishing. Maybe every year I cross off a few that I thought I would never ever be able to finish. Like last year when I finished Muramasa, and I thought there was no way I was going to finish that. Managed it somehow, just perseverance. That's kind of the thing with these kind of goals. It encourages that perseverance and like the achievement of doing things that you thought you wouldn't do. Which a lot of the site is about, really.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very much so. Which is why I figured this topic was particularly interesting for us. Mm.
And the reason why I talked about where I started is because a lot of people look at people with certain goals more than they have. Like, say, people with, like, I don't know, 500,000 true trophy score, which I am nowhere near, or, like, 500 completed games or whatever it is. Like, if it's a completion percentage or whatever you think you can't get, that person started with less, started with what you have, and if you aim for it, you know, you just have to go for it. You can get it.
You too can be a Power Ranger.
Yeah.
I don't know why I said that. That just, you know, it was in there. So,
just want to break some hearts.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know, Power Rangers are awesome. So, anyways, how about you, Ace? What do you got going on?
Let's see. I want to finish the Lego Marvel games, Lego Avengers, before Marvel Super Heroes 2 comes out in November. I've still got Lego Dimensions that I haven't started yet, so I want to start that before the end of the year and try and get all the Lego games that I've got finished before the end of 2018 anyway.
How many Lego games are we talking?
It's a few. I'm not quite sure the number.
Give us a ballpark. Is it
so, I think.
Okay.
Do you have them in physical form or digital?
Physical.
You should stack up the boxes and try and build something.
Yeah.
That does sound appropriate. It would have to be an airplane, though, because we all know that the appropriate thing to try to do with Legos is make an airplane.
Mm. And then just still trying to get through all of my old games, get all the multiplayer trophies if there's any left, and then just finishing story, single player trophies, trying to get all the PS3 stuff done and finished.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
The games that I have created.
That's a tall order.
Yeah.
I would love to finish off all my PS3 games and just like be done with the console, but you know, it's an impossible goal.
Honestly, like I want to do the same, especially because I got my PS3 less than a year before I got my PS4. So thanks. I was like, oh yeah, all these used games, like $3-5 each. I'm just going to grab a whole bunch of them.
No, you bought too many.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, it didn't cost me a lot of money, but I ended up with a whole bunch of them, and now I've got tons of PS3 games that I've just never even played because, you know, newer things came out, and that's kind of what happens.
Mm.
So, how are you feeling about that, Ace? You think you're going to be able to do this?
Yeah. I don't like to say that I can get all my PS3 games done by the end of 2018, but I'm going to try and get a big dent out of the way, I should hope, before the end of 2018. Mm-hmm. I kind of had a few years off with changes at home with family getting bigger and stuff, so I kind of had quite a lull for a long period, and now I'm trying to get back to it and finish them off. So I think trying to get it before the end of 2018 is going to be a bit on the stretch, but hopefully maybe get the completion percentage up into the higher numbers.
Well, at the very least, your goal should be to get as much done as you can so that come next year when you're setting your goals, it's not a goal because you're that close.
Yeah, yeah.
Right.
That would be the ideal, yeah.
Mm-hmm. So, my goals, I actually set goals for some reason at the beginning of the year instead of doing the normal New Year's resolution stuff. I just set goals on TT.
No, that's good. It's like gaming resolutions.
Yeah, it's kind of disturbing because I kind of approach this in the same way that I approach it. These kinds of things at work. And so I was like, what number am I going to go for? And so like my goals for the year starting as of January was basically like almost a 25% increase across the board. Okay. So
versus how many years of playing?
I got my PS3 January of 2013 and I've played mostly PlayStation games since. So at this point, what are we talking, four and a half years? Well, it would have been 4 years.
Yeah, four and a half.
Yeah.
Yeah, so, four at the time, you're right.
Yeah. So it would have been about 4 years. So 25% is not entirely unreasonable. I didn't at one point look at all of my summaries, because you can go back, obviously, and look at your monthly summaries and all that kind of stuff. And I looked at my monthly summaries and my year summaries, and I noticed a downward trend, and I was like, well, you know what? I'm going to try and aim higher than what I did last year. So I've got three major goals, and I actually started another one today just because I kind of realized something when I was looking at these three goals. So I want to have completed 71 games by the end of this year. I started at 51. So that's about 20 games. So it's, 40%, I guess.
Okay.
That's one's a little bit...
The maths went a bit sideways on that one.
Yeah, well, I think it was just kind of based on, I think I took my my best year and I was like, I'm going to try and beat that.
All right, good.
I think that was probably 2013 where I had a whole bunch of completions. So my goal is to get 20. I'm about 25% of the way there, and we're almost halfway through the year. So this one's looking a little bit tough, but it's maybe possible.
Just to explain that for anyone listening that hasn't used the goals feature on the site, when you look at the goals page, either your own or one of your friends' goals pages, you can see the two bars. You can see the time progress. And so obviously now we're in June, we're about halfway through the year, and you can see the goal progress. So between the 51 that I can see he started at and the 71 that I can see he's aiming for, he's only 25% of the way there. So in contrast, like you're sort of making half speed at the moment. You'll need to do a bit of a hare versus tortoise sprint finish at this rate.
Yeah. So I wanted to complete the games, about 20 games. And part of it was I was thinking that I'd probably end up playing a bunch more indie games this year. And it turns out that this year has been one of the weaker years for, not weaker years. It has not had as many, hey, you need to play this indie, I feel like, compared to how many AAA exclusive games have come out this year. And so I've been playing, instead of smaller games, a whole bunch of really big games. And so that's kind of a huge part of the reason why I'm going a little bit slow.
I can think of a few.
Yeah, I know, right? My next one, which is probably what I'm doing a little bit better in because of that, is I decided that I'd go for platinums as well. So I started at 32. I'm aiming for 44. So that's about a third, I guess. So 12 new ones. I think that, again, that's probably my best year I'm aiming for there. This one's going much better. I'm about 42% of the way there. So this one's a little bit closer. And again, I think I've got some Telltale games that I'm probably going to clean up. So.
And I assume the Persona 5 Platinum is on the way.
Yeah, I was hoping to have it done by the end of today, actually. Except I missed one item from one of Mishima's friggin' little request things. And
come on, now, man.
I know. So, I have to go back, and thankfully it shouldn't cost me too much time, but it is going to cost me time. And it's like, goddamn. And if I was just not rushing, I would have caught it.
Load an earlier save.
Well, I didn't delete my save, but I was saving infrequently because I was just blowing through stuff.
I never save infrequently.
I know. Well, I mean, if I had been saving more frequently, I probably wouldn't even have that save because I would have gone over it by this point.
Okay.
So, yes. So, anyways, so I'm aiming for 44, about 42% of the way there on that one. And then I was aiming for getting a whole bunch of trophies, 700 trophies this year, going from 2361 to 3061. I'm about 40% of the way through that. And then I kind of realized that all of this would be encouraging me to play easier games.
Mm-hmm.
So I did actually make a goal today to increase my ratio from, I think it's 1.54 to 1.65 by the end of the year.
And so, you know what that means? The way to get all three of those at the same time is to focus on platinums of games you've already started and not start too many new games.
Yeah, but that's not going to happen.
Well, you've got these goals. You can aim for it.
Yeah, but I mean, that's not going to happen. I'll just have to play
nice
more.
Nice determination.
Games. I'm just going to spend more time playing games and playing harder games. And yeah, so. But anyway, so those are my goals. So if you checked the page for the podcast last week on the site, I managed to fit a poll in there. So I'm going to try and do that going forward. We're going to have a poll this week. Having a complex poll of, like, you know, what your goal is obviously would be a little bit difficult. So that stuff you can put in the comments if you'd like. But what I wanted to ask was, what stat are you most focused on? Because I think everybody kind of has a stat that they're big on. Some people want the biggest TT score or their biggest experience, you know, PlayStation experience score, best ratio. Some people are completion people like Prince,
or completed games alternatively and quite different.
Right. Yeah. Or platinums or whatever, you know, each person's kind of got their own thing. So I'm going to toss that in there and you can let us know what your main goal is when you're playing games. What's that one badge that you look at on your profile and you keep pushing on that one?
I think, I don't know about you, but I'm thinking, it would be a good idea for everyone, including Ace at this point. I guess you're exempt, Brandon, but yeah. For everyone to add, no matter how many goals you have now and no matter what they look like, think of one thing, one goal that you could add which you think would make your next 6 months more fun.
Yeah. So, do you guys have anything? Or we holding off on
that's until like next week? To do after the podcast, something to think about.
Yeah, okay, sounds good. We'll hold on to that until next week, and we'll report back. All right, moving on. It's time for popular trophies. There we go.
Yep. Welcome to Popular Trophies, Top of the Pops for June 27th, 2017. Strangely enough, this week there's nothing that's left the chart that was there last week, so we don't have to say goodbye to anyone.
Yeah.
We've got, so you can probably guess the majority of the chart then. Well, we've got two others that have snuck in. So, once again, it's quite heavy with the PS Plus titles and or free titles. Down at number five, we've got Horizon Zero Dawn, still clinging in there with reached level 10, 184 wins, plus 11 other trophies in the chart. So pretty good showing still. I think
hanging in there.
I think that may stick around for another week or so at the bottom of the chart. Next, we've got a new entry at number four. Nex Machina at spot 15.
Yeah. So my apologies, folks. I did not know this was coming out last week, and obviously this would have been an easy recommendation. I've been playing it, and I'll talk about that later, but this is the latest Housemarque game, and so obviously it's pretty awesome.
I think we did mention it, didn't we?
Oh, well, then I wasn't paying attention at that point.
It's Housemarque, the makers of Dead Nation and Resogun and Super Stardust, am I right?
Yes. Yes, those people. And so it would have been a very easy prediction when we were like, oh, what's going to be on next time? If I was actually paying attention and heard that, I would have been like, oh my God, that's obviously going to be on the list. So here it is.
Why are you running 206 wins plus 8 other trophies in the top 50? So, you know, I mean, I suppose that's a good number of trophies in the chart, but it's not a huge lot of wins for a sort of new release. They're a bit on the quiet side, maybe.
Yeah, well, I don't know what's up with that, but I mean, there's not a whole lot of wins even for the top trophy. So
true, it's generally a bit of a quiet week.
People are still digesting E3 stuff, I think.
At number three, down one spot from last week, is Life is Strange. Same trophy, Macro Eyes, the first optional photograph in episode one. 224 wins, plus 6 other trophies. So, interesting. It still seems people are still kind of starting that one, not doing the other episodes yet.
Yeah.
Then at number two, down from the first spot from last week, is Killing Floor 2. It's only a flesh wound, same trophy as before. It's 386 wins this week with 14 other trophies. Compare that to last week, which was slightly more at 462 wins, plus 26 other trophies. And, of course, the week before that, of 1,432 wins, plus 24 other trophies, when it was first released on PS Plus for free. So it's...
Well, yeah, it's hanging in there.
It's hanging in there, yeah.
But it's fallen quite precipitously. And 1,400 wins is a lot of wins. So
yeah,
for it to still have people getting this trophy at this point is something.
it's quite a lot, especially if you add up all of them together as well. You know, looking at over 2,000 wins for the sort of 3-week period. I expect, and it's at, you know, at spot two, so we'll remain to see if it still keeps going next week and beyond, but it certainly seems quite popular. I mean, Life is Strange is also quite good in there as well, but obviously it doesn't have quite the same number of trophies that may be against it. Or
yep.
I don't know. Life is Strange was quite well publicized at the time, and it's been on a lot of sales and things since. So I'd say a lot of people were aware of that one and have that one or played that one. But I'm not that familiar with Killing Floor 2, so maybe there's a lot more scope there, being free, for people to pick it up and do it, and that's why it's maybe the more popular of the titles at the moment from PS Plus for trophy unlocks.
Yeah, I mean, it's got an incredible amount of staying power for, you know, I mean, we've seen much larger games fall faster.
Yeah. And then at number one, I presume this is following on from our news from last week, it's Hitman at spot one, a trophy called Shh, 386 wins plus 6 other trophies. I believe this forms the free content of the first two locations that they released onto PSN.
Almost certainly.
Yeah. So obviously everyone taking up the opportunity there. It'd be interesting to see actually how, if we start to see any more trophies maybe in like the following week, because actually seems to have rather good discounts on it at the moment on the PSN store. I think it's cheaper than actually what's on the news report when I looked to check.
If you have Plus, then it's £18.
Oh, is it? Oh, it's an additional discount for Plus, is it? Okay. So.
Gotcha.
Yeah, I don't. So, if people enjoyed it, then hopefully maybe they'll jump for the full game with the Plus discount.
Yeah,
and we might see more trophies from Hitman appearing next week.
Yeah. So I don't know if I expect Hitman to stick around for too long. It very well may if it actually, you know, finds a solid audience this way. But I don't expect it to stick around very long. And then what is coming out this week, but Crash. Crash is coming out on the 30th. So I'm going to say that's probably my big bet. I'm sure that's going to probably make the top of the list, even though it's coming out, what, on Friday? I still think a lot of people will end up playing that. And I think it's going to have some very low-hanging fruit.
Yeah.
Sorry, that was unintentional. I didn't even think about that. I was literally thinking to myself, too, it's going to be like a trophy to like get the first apple or something. And it just, my brain was just so mushy. Oh, man, that was so bad. Okay. All right, so...
Although, what's Elite Dangerous came out today? Was it today? Yes.
I don't know if it's actually the game, or is it something associated?
I thought it was the game for PlayStation 4, because it was out on PC. So, I guess it depends whether Spaceflight or Nostalgia, Crash Bandicoot. Well, I suppose Crash Bandicoot, it's got... Is it three separate, or is it no two? So two separate trophy lists, isn't it? Crash Bandicoot and Crash Bandicoot 2.
Well, I mean, there's three games, so I'm assuming
three games. So yeah, might. So that might have a bit more for it. So it could be like you say, it could be an utter crash trophy list next week, trophy chart next week.
Moving on, I think we might skip what we've been playing. I am going to say that I've been playing Nex Machina, and it's been pretty fun. And the first world, I didn't think much of it, and then I got into the second world, and I started to see, you know, just how complex it was. And by the time I got to the second boss, I was like, oh my god, this game is insane. I don't even know how I was managing to play without dying. I think I was mostly just lucky. But it is a lot of fun, and I can see where... it's going to be like Rezogun, but maybe even a little bit stronger in some ways. I think it's got a lot more flexibility, whereas Rezogun had a lot to do with sort of puzzling out the best route. Nex Machina's got a lot more going on that keeps you sort of reformulating your strategy. Like your humans, you can build up a chain for saving humans, but... the timer is constantly counting down on that, so you kind of want to space out how often you save humans so that you can maximize your the amount of time you have that chain going without it expiring. So and then even the encounters, you go into various very complex encounters very quickly, and you've got a whole bunch of stuff going on, and each one is drastically different. So it does, you know, each one has its own sort of difficulties and almost sort of a puzzly element to how you unravel this kind of chaos going on around you. So far, I am having a whole bunch of fun, and I am going to play a whole bunch more of this, and then I'm probably going to get lost in it, and hopefully this will be my next platinum if the trophies aren't hideous like with Alienation. As long as it's not like Alienation, which was just kind of hideous and required a huge time sink.
Dead Nation is one of those games I started a decade ago and haven't finished.
Yeah. And then finally, real quick, trivia. I'm just going to throw it in there real quick. So with Nex Machina coming out and Housemarque being amazing, which of these Housemarque games has the highest TT ratio? Of these games, I have chosen the highest ratio of that one because you've, for instance, got Super Stardust has come out several times, Dead Nation's come out several times in different editions. So I've just chosen whichever one was highest up for the sake of being competitive. So which of these games has the highest TT ratio? Is it Rezogun, Alienation, Super Stardust Ultra, Dead Nation Apocalypse Edition, or Outland?
I go with my gut, Stardust.
All right.
I was going to say that one as well, because I remember
Death
thinking...
Death Rezogun, it's probably equally likely.
Yeah. All right, fine. I'll go with Rezogun then.
Unfortunately, it is neither of those. It's actually Dead Nation Apocalypse Edition.
Well, I should have known, because...
Yeah, I was just going to say... I was like, well, Prince has got this one in the back. It appears not. So
I assume that's the rest.
Yeah. You assume that you're the outlier in that situation. But anyways, so we've got to run. Thanks for joining us. Follow us on the site, on iTunes, on YouTube. We're on Google Play. You can follow us on Twitter at True Trophies. I'm Megabrand Zero. Ace is Asola McLeod. And until next time, have fun. We'll see you soon. Bye.
See you around.
See ya.